The issue of blast injury started with World War I. World War I was the first significant battle in which high explosives were used in warfare. And this was the trench warfare in, on the Western Front, the Battle of Verdun, and things like that that we're now celebrating 100-year anniversaries of, and things like that, where individuals were in trenches and were exposed on a daily basis to literally hundreds of explosions. And soon after this, an entity was seen that was referred to as shell shock, or sometimes neurasthenia, that has many of the features of what we see today in our returning service members. The headaches, the difficulty concentrating, the behavioral manifestations that we talked about. It was called shell shock. It was not well defined. Nobody really knew quite what to do with it or how to treat it. And there was, in those days, 100 years ago, a debate in the literature as well as in academic circles as to whether this was actual physical damage to the brain or whether this was a mental health problem. And at the end of World War I, a commission was put together by the British government, and they looked into it, and they decided that shell shock was really not a proper clinical entity, the term should not be used, and that they didn't feel there was evidence of damage to the brain, that this was all a mental health problem. And that has continued till this day. We couldn't use shell shock in World War II, so we called it combat fatigue or battle fatigue. When we got to Vietnam, psychiatrists involved in dealing with this problem in Vietnam introduced the term of post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, and we've continued to use that to this day. But really, over the 100 years of history, of this specifically military problem, nobody had actually looked at the brains to see whether this, you know, there was any evidence to solve this debate until we stepped in and did our work. This is a very difficult problem because the patients that are affected by it have both these neurologic problems, they have severe intractable headaches, they've got severe sleep disorder, they're not sleeping at night, they have problems concentrating, they have problems with vision, and they have these behavioral issues in terms of mood swings, in terms of ability to plan, in terms of recognizing the consequences of one's actions. These are all things that are controlled by the frontal lobes of the brain, which are severely affected, incidentally, by this scarring problem. At any rate, and so dealing with society has always been a problem for these patients. I mean, this goes back to shell shock, really. The shell shock victims could not go back really to be, you know, productive members of society. They couldn't work. It was a difficult problem in terms of readjusting to society, and we see this to this day. This disrupts family life. Many of these families end up in divorce, child abuse, spousal abuse. I mean, this is a very complex problem that has just been implanted in our society in virtually every corner of the United States with these returning deployed, post-deployed service members.